Hello everyone. Thanks to everyone for watching this video. My name is Qida. I am an architect and engineer. Today's video is titled Masonry Arch Bridge, and it is going to provide you a broad overview of Masonry Arch Bridges and also the assessment of the bridge carrying capacity. I am going to give you an overview of what I am covering today's video. First at all, we will have a look at some fundamentals of the behavior of masonry arch bridges and how that relates to masonry arch bridge analysis. Then, move on to how we actually applied models to analyze masonry arch bridges, and we will round up with examples of arch viral and backfilled arch bridges, then wrap up with conclusions. Okay, first at all, we have a look at masonry bridges. What do we know about them? We know many countries approaching 50% of the bridges on the road and the rail networks are masonry arch bridges. Recommends around a million spans worldwide, and the vast majority of them are well over 100 years old. We need to assess these bridges if they are carrying traffic to check the defect for purpose. We often find that they are being subjected to more onerous loads, so that we regularly assess their capability to carry those loads. If you are not familiar with masonry arch bridges, or just a sort of be aware, there is the square of terminology that you need to become accustomed. Basically, you have a masonry arch barrel which spans between abutments. The arch barrel can be formed of large stone voussoirs, or it can be composed of brickwork often arranged in multiple rings separated by continuous mortar joints. So that is the arch barrel. Then to form a nice road level or rail surface, we would normally put in fill above the barrel, and we may have backing as well, which is typically formed from masonry or concrete directly behind the hinges of the arch barrel, in order to provide additional resistance. I am not going to go into great detail about how arch bridges stand up or fall down. However, there is a really nice theory which I think I am going to nevertheless explain to you. It is a theory developed by Robert Hooke. Several hundred years ago, he observed a weightless chain would take up if you look at the profile of a weightless chain. And then you have taken the mirror image of that, you get the ideal form for a masonry arch. It hangs a weightless chain, but inverted stands the masonry arch. I've got on screen now is the profile of a hanging weightless chain. But we've actually suspended from that the voussoirs that we are going to use to form the masonry arch. If that profile fits entirely within the masonry, then assuming we don't get sliding failure, then we can say that the arch bridge is safe to carry its self weight. Of course, the observation is that there are a number of these profiles, if we can now call a line of thrust or a line of compression, that fit entirely within the thinness of the masonry, because we are dealing with the statically indeterminate form. So you can see we've got three different forms which profiles fit within the thinness of the masonry. Unless you know something about the history of your arch materials of which it's formed, and then you can't categorically say how your bridge is actually carrying the load. However, if you apply, for example, a load at a quarter span and you carry on increasing that load, comes a point where you can only just fit the profile of the line of thrust inside the masonry. Actually, at that point, you have a unique identifier of what the load carrying capacity of your structure. It is now determined there is only one line of thrust. If you apply any more load at all, you will get hinges and you will get a failure mechanism. So, effectively, we can use this to do an analysis of a bridge collapse. What is that telling? The telling is that the shape of the arch in related reason to the loading governs stability. So, originally with the first example, we just had self-weight loading, but then we applied a quarter-span load. So the shape of the arch in relation to the path of loading governs stability. We haven't talked about yet is that if you surround your arch with few material, which we particularly do in Masonry arch bridge, then you can get additional reserves of strength. Basically, the field disperses the applied load through the field, which is beneficial. It pre-stresses the barrel just from its self-weight. As the arch tries to sway into the surrounding field material, then you get horizontal passive restraint. The third point is that current assessment methods tend to focus on the ultimate limit state, assuming implicitly the serviceability limit state is satisfied. Now, remove the foot to change that to look at the serviceability limit state criteria for assessment. But in common, most assessment codes will focus on the ultimate limit state, which is what the focus of today's talk is. Okay, how do we do a Masonry arch analysis using a useful method? Actually, the mathematics are fairly simple. We maximize a load factor as a multiplier or additive factor on an external load in a problem subjected to equilibrium constraints. For example, a single block in a pier, what we are looking for is that block force equilibrium in the XY and the rotational sense. What are the force is applied to the block? Obviously self-weight load, but it is also forces at the contacts, and so we've actually got a highlighted contact. We've got a normal force, a moment, and a shear force. We impose limits on those values. For example, the shear force is limited by the normal force and the coefficient of friction. Similarly, the moment is limited by the thickness and the normal force, assuming infinite compressive strength. Actually, we have a nonlinear constraint where we have finite compressive strength. So, maximize lambda safely to equilibrium and yield. The nice thing about this is a linear optimization problem, which means it is easy to solve. In terms of verification, the rigid block analysis was validated by 2-3 meter span bare arch ribs. As no backfill material was present, there was no soil structure interaction. We get a good correlation between the numerical and the experimental results. Okay, how do we do a backfilled Masonry arch bridge analysis using a useful method? For sake of simplicity, soil arch interaction has been assumed to comprise of 2 independent components: transference of the applied load to the arch and passive resistance as the collapsing arch moves into the backfill. The self-weight of the backfill also plays an important role in enhancing arch stability. For small loads and negligible arch movements, Boussinesq stress distribution is used to estimate the increase in vertical stresses due to the live load. Whilst the kinematics of the arch and the soil on the passive side are more closely related to an anchor pullout, analysis tend to apply classical retaining wall theory to compute changes in the horizontal stresses. We can go through and look at the correlation between the experimental results and the numerical results and check that we are getting reasonable correlation. From conclusions, what we learned, the shape of the arch in relation to the pattern of loading is important. So measure the shape, but also be careful with the pattern of loading. For example, for beam bridges, we are quite happy to use generic load types. For masonry arch bridges, actually the distribution of axial loads is important. If you can model a true representation of the arch shape and also a true representation to loading that is going to be carrying, that is very useful. Rigid block method is a rapid and powerful tool for masonry arch bridge analysis. It automatically identifies many modes of failure and what the critical model response says. Okay, thanks to everyone for watching my video today, and I do hope you found the video informative and that you learned some things from it. If you do have any questions, then you can write comments and messages. I am happy to answer any questions. Thanks for your watching.